Melody Anderson and Sam J. Joe.
Me. And all the headpieces, I had so many pins sticking this stuff into my head. I still have the scars to show for it. And now here's a hint. If you're a real aficionado, let me tell you something to look for, because you can see, you know, when they edit, they do some things earlier and then later to match and all this. Well, in the scene where I've got the gun, the orange dangly thing, they made this crown, and I wore it a lot in the movie. They made this crown, and it was like a plasterboard on leather, I mean, plaster on leather, and then they put little beads on. But because I wore it so much throughout the sequence of shooting, it starts to bend more and more and more, and you can see which shots are out of sequence, depending on where this thing is. Mine were without Sam. That was always great. Now, happy to work with him.
Well, I'm going to say Melody, because she's here. we had a great relationship.
Oh, we did.
We really were like brother and sister. You lived with Lynn and I.
That's right.
In London for
a couple of weeks before I got my own place.
Couple of weeks.
You guys kicked me out.
We were the only two Americans on the entire set. A lot of English, great to work with them. And then, of course, Dino smuggled about 200 Italians over, I think, eventually. Smart guys.
Dino's your
But no, it was wonderful. We were the only two Americans, so we bonded really well. And I think the favorite scene, of course, was the football scene where Baldwin's had an opportunity to add it and improvise.
Well, let me tell you something. As much as I don't like him, he's very smart. And that scene originally, we created that whole scene. And it started with Sam, because we know who plays for the New York Jets, right? And so we came onto the set, and they were sort of pulling those sort of Fabergé eggs, and we were supposed to walk in and have a fight, and that would be the end of the scene. And then Sam is looking at those eggs and says, they look like
footballs. Yeah, it took a lot of brainstorming. Very good.
So he
made it work.
He worked with the fight coordinator in making a football thing, and that's where the light go flash go came with, because if he's the all-American boy, I'm supposed to be the all-American girl, and the football game, I gotta be cheerleader. Yeah. And so I carried that throughout the movie. It was never written, and I never got any money for it.
I was just wondering what the filming environment was like with some of the actors you're with, especially Ryan Blessed seems to be a little bit nuts.
Oh, it's you. Let
me go first. Ryan, you tell me, Ryan's the impact that he has. No, he's incredible. I mean, just he's a take charge kind of guy. He kept everybody in stitches. The jokester.
That's my stomach.
There's a great breakfast place upstairs. But anyway, now we've been fortunate enough to do a couple of conventions with Ryan. Ryan is something else. If he was here right now, he would take his microphone, literally, physically, and sit right here downstage at the end, sit right there, get into a 10-minute monologue, and every couple of seconds he would look back to us and he would say, "Isn't Sam and Melody beautiful?" Now that's and he's brilliant at this. Now Melody thinks he's half out of his mind, but if you Google all the things that he said he has done and doing, it's actually
He's done climbing Everest and Africa.
Four times.
He
didn't make it to the top each time. There was one, the first time he got a call from his mom, "You have to come home now."
There was always this kind of story where it didn't quite happen. But he was wonderful. I had a lot of time with him, and Sam was on the rotating disc with Timothy. And so I was in the background with Ryan, and I tell you, I almost needed some diapers. He made me laugh the whole time. And that scene where he pinches me on the table, that was totally him. And of course, you know, when you're an actor, you go with it. And of course, he made acting so exciting because he's so vibrant. But the whole cast was, we were very blessed. We had amazing, Max von Sydow was the king of all kings. Oh, I think he did a movie. And Ornella and I became friends, and she lived in LA for a while, we stayed in contact.
Now that's a sexy woman right there, let me tell you.
Thank you, right here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It was a special relationship.
I'll be honest.
Nothing happened. Okay. Nothing. He never allowed me. I felt so bad.
One little dramatic outburst, and that was it. It quenched everything.
In the football sequence, how many times did it take to throw the ball before she caught it?
How many times did it take to do what? Or to throw that ball?
You played football.
Yeah, oh yeah, but I played Marine Corps football before the film industry.
I ain't got nothing to do with your question.
Okay, sorry, man. Let the top and give me 50 push-ups.
I'm 72, so I can't do 50.
I'm 72. Oh my gosh, you're looking pretty good, buddy. Pretty good.
How many weeks of production did y'all shoot?
Oh, we shot.
It was five and a half months. So if you divide four into that over 100 years, that's a lot of weeks here.
Howdy, thanks for coming. Yeah. Huge fan of the movie. It's one of my earliest, most favorite movie going memories. And yeah, there was a screening just the other night here in town. That's a good crowd. We had a good time.
Yes, it is, yeah.
Was the music, did you know anything about the Queen stuff beforehand? I assume not, but had anyone heard anything?
Did you follow Queen before 1979?
Yes, I listened to them before then, yeah. And we had no idea it was going to be, I mean, obviously it's going to be pretty good.
Yeah.
But it was so fitting for the movie, and fortunately I got to meet them. Sam at the work, and I got to meet them, and they were just lovely, and that made so much of the movie. The music is such a powerful piece of the film.
It's perfect.
Yeah, not only complimented Flash Gordon, it brought high value.
Mm-hmm.
It had a lot to do with the success.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Yes. Debbie's over here, guys. You have a question for Debbie?
No.
This woman wrote The Wizards.
Yes.
God.
I will say, though, that we had a Flash Gordon panel a couple years ago, which we were very sorry because we're not here for. But every time a panelist said Flash, the audience had to respond with,
"Aww."
And some of them were there.
There was a glitch in the DragonCon scheduling system a couple of years ago, and you know, as directors, you go in, you schedule all the panels, and somehow they put Thursday night in by accident. So we thought, okay, we put something there, and we put a Flash Gordon panel and filled up the track room, and you sang the songs. It was huge.
Who was speaking at the panel? The Flash Gordon panel.
Just us.
Yeah.
Wow.
Somebody's gonna be hearing from me.
And we were all harassing Joan, like, when are you gonna get Melanie and Sam here?
Yeah.
I believe I said I will drive to their houses.
You did. You really did.
But we're here now, so let's Captain.
Speaking of Queen, I just wanted to say before the question that for me and my wife's wedding, we actually had a Flash Gordon wedding march.
Did you repeat the same vow? What was it? Do you swear to honor her until you become tired of her?
I think it would have been the other way around. So, I already have my earlier question answered. My friend was, it does seem like a complete bloom, fantastic. Same thing with the rest of the cast, with Topol and just pretty much everyone. I expect to see now. I mean, just
ask her about Topol.
Okay, what about Topol?
I
imagine getting the rocket seat where you launch into Mongo and that whole thing. It's just, it really feels like the comic book just come to life. You know, it just feels like panel after panel after panel.
That's also, again, back in Jamila Donati. He really got those comic book colors, really. And if you ever watch Doom, you will see so many of the Flash Gordon sets on Doom. Tina likes to, you know, make money. I don't know. Thank you.
Hi. Big fan. Obviously, you worked with a very young Timothy Dalton at the time. It was one of his early roles. What was your reaction when you found out that he had landed in a role as the next James Bond? Did it make sense, you know, fitting his personality? Did you get to talk to him afterwards?
I got a question for you. How long have you been a musician?
Well, about the last 15 years.
Yeah, I can see that. Are you playing locally?
Not here in the next few months, no.
Okay, cool. So what was our reaction about Timothy becoming
the James Bond in the big role? Yeah.
Well, I think number one, it's always a blessing anytime
that you get another job.
I think he ended up doing two, right?
Yeah.
Two.
Yeah.
And then they were shooting the third one, but they pulled it or something like that. It's always a blessing, you know, when we work, and we never know how they're going to turn out. Flash Gordon. People ask me all the time. Did you know it was going to turn out? Absolutely not. We had no idea it would evolve into this. We're sitting here 37 years later. And it's wonderful. It really is wonderful.
Thank you so much.
You got it. You know how I can tell? It's not just about how you look. But when you grab that microphone, you owned it, brother. You owned that microphone.
Have any of you seen the film Flesh Gordon? No.
Other than me, no, our first week of filming, they said, hey, we have to take you to see this film called Flash Gordon. I didn't put that together. You know, hey, remember, Flash Gordon has no superpowers. He relies solely on his athleticism and his wit when it's working properly. So, Flash just kind of went, So we're sitting there watching it, and I went, oh, I see what you're being
asked. There's no we here.
But yeah, I had no idea. It was, but they did stay loyal to the characters as far as, right? I mean, there was Ming, the world, yeah, I mean, everybody else.
Okay, moving right along.
How's it going? So, Flash Gordon is kind of a time capsule of the 80s. So if Flash Gordon were to be rebooted, who do you think would be this generation's Flash Gordon?
Oh, that absolutely me. Are you kidding me? Fox, Matthew Riley, he's in the VP of production at Fox. He bought the screenplay rights about 2 years ago, and I met with him and I said, whatever you need me for. And I don't know if you know this, but this happens a lot where, well, let's just take Flash Gordon. It's been, the screenplay rights have been bought numerous times over the years, by reputable people. The last two before Fox was Neil Moritz, Fast and Furious, right? And before that, Steven Summers, Van Helsing. And for some strange reason, They did not follow through and pick up the option.
Because they can't find another Flash.
Yeah, maybe that's it's all about the timing. So it's been 2 years in development, and the reason why I think if this is going to come to fruition is because, just like Seth MacFarlane, oops, sorry, it's Seth MacFarlane. If you don't understand the joke, I'll have her explain it to you. But, anyways, Matthew called me, just like Seth called me. When they were both 8 years old, many years ago, it had a huge impact. Flash Gordon and myself had a huge impact on these young men and women. They grew up to become sort of iconic decision makers in Hollywood. So Fox now has not just acquired the rights in development, but there's a personal touch that Matthew has. So hopefully it comes to fruition.
Kind of follow up his question, if they do make the remake, what would be your ideal role in that remake? If it could be Flash, could be Dale, what would you envision yourself?
What would I envision myself? I would say that I would be Dale, and I would be the President of the United States. The first woman President of the United States. And Flash would be my Secretary of State. But that would be the whole universe. We'd have to do diplomatic missions throughout the universe. I just made that up.
I'm going to ask a question about the scene in the plane when you're seeing all the weird stuff out of the window. Are you actually, is there like a monitor set up so you can see all of that, or are they on set, or they're telling you this is out the window?
Oh, come on, we didn't see anything.
No, we have a green screen. Back in those days, this is before CGI, when you really look at the kind of work that was done on Flash, it was done. Oh my God.
Let me ask you.
It's the cops. They follow me. I swear, I was me on the grassy knoll in Texas. Oh my goodness. Okay, sorry about that. No. This guy's a thief. When all of you come over to get your thing signed, just count your fingers when you get it back.
We have an interesting story about our money. I kept, when you do movies for any time, especially Flash Gordon, that they paid me an exorbitant amount of money for my per diem, my daily living money. So in my sock and underwear drawer, and so I'm not making this up, this is back when they called it stupid money. I think they're paying me $1,000 a week per diem, which is really a stupid money.
Back in 1979.
So I had after a couple of months, and I didn't have to spend a penny because I'd get up at 4 in the morning, we'd work out, breakfast, run around the Hyde Park, exercise, get to the studio, come home, go to sleep. So I never had to spend a dime, so after a couple of months, I had thousands and thousands of per diem in my sock and underwear drawer. So I used to, whenever I would go into her room, I'd check her sock and underwear drawer.
This is the first time I heard this. You didn't put them on. I'm okay.
I have a quick question for Melody. One of the things that I thought was amazing about what you did with Dale Arden is she is sexy, and yet she is strong and smart. She is truly one of the first really awesome female heroes that we saw on screen in that regard. What was it like for you to be able to do that, to bring that kind of character to life?
Well, certainly I was in those days. We were talking about women's lives. And, I really wanted to move her away from being the kind of heroine. And even I watched the Buster Crabbe movies to see what the whole concept, because I wasn't familiar with Flash Gordon. And she kind of, you kind of wanted to hit her and say, do something. So I'm just whining, do something. And so I just really, and also remember, I'm a New York City girl. Right? So I got to have a little bit of that. And I wanted her to be a heroine that had a lot of strength. And that's one of the reasons why the Gold Flash Go, as much as that was she was a cheerleader. I was a good cheerleader. I made sure I was always fighting the bad guys. It was really important to me to put that across for the girls.
You did a great job with it.
Thank you. Coming from you,
much.
Question for Melody. Building on to that, at one point, you know, you've got the laser gun, you're doing cartwheels around shooting the bad guys and stuff like that. Well, I was watching a movie with a friend of mine, and she was asking, you know, where did she use the college part? Of course, being a travel agent, the training that she did. Did you actually train with travel agents to do all that combat work? And Sam, in your security company, did you employ those same methods of self-defense in your company?
So the question is, did Melody do a lot of the stunts and fight scenes herself? And the same thing.
Did she train with travel agents for those fight scenes?
Did we train for it?
Well, she stole my question. I had to think of something.
Unfortunately, the mic is all fuzzy off by the time we get you here. Why don't you just put that down and yell at
me? Yeah, come on, just speak it normal. We don't need no mic in the front of my
television and movies. Melody, you were in Animal.
bracket and put me in. That was probably if the tax bracket and I didn't have more notoriety, it didn't last forever. That's the worst of that. Everything has been wonderful.
But did you do the Merv Griffin show?
I did the Merv Griffin show.
You did, right? Oh, that was huge. Merv was huge. I understand why I didn't have you though. But anyway, no, look, he was all over you. You kidding me? He was known to, right? Come on.
I got a new friend.
Yes. Now, you would have been great. You should have done the Johnny. Why didn't we do the Johnny Carson show?
I don't know.
What did happen?
It's dead now. It's too late.
Thank you for sharing that. Well, it's been so cool. You know, this longevity thing is wonderful. We're getting people to come up to our table now. Before it was our age and our children, and now it's our children's children. I'll get grandma, daughter, and granddaughter to come up to my table. It's wonderful. And then I get, you know, I know Melody, this has happened. And Melody's incredible. I don't know if you knew this. She's also not just a certified, but she's a top.
I'm certified.
Yeah, she's a family therapist, and she's one of the top in the nation. And so with that said, I'm getting these stories with people that come up to my table. And in the beginning, you know, they'll say, hey, man, you really had a great impact on me as a child. And my first thought over the years, oh, that's nice, that's kind of cute and all that. But then you start listening, and I have to turn away sometimes when they're done telling me because I get kind of emotional. It wasn't just about, being a good or positive influence. It was stories like, my parents were alcoholics. They were very abusive to each other and to me. And when I was 8 and 9 years old, I would lock myself in my room with my VHS of Flash Gordon, where I was suicidal. And until I hit that play button, I wanted to live. So you're hearing, I'm hearing, wait a minute. I saved their life. I mean, you know, I had an impact on actually why they're here standing in front of me right now. And you hear all these athletes and celebrities say, oh, I'm not a role model. Well, get over yourself. No matter what you think you are or you're not, we are role models for this youth. Now they're in their 40s and 50s and plus. And we had something to do with them still being alive and maybe stepping into, their greatness right now and their skill set. That's really wonderful. So I can't see any backside.
What kind of impact do you think that the movie had on like your children and grandchildren the first time that they watched it? And do you think that age group is going to carry on the legacy of Flash Gordon?
It's funny, you know, my kids are different ages. They're 15, 17, 19, 28, and 33, and I have 3 grandchildren. So really, during the Flash Gordon, that's 37 years ago, so I didn't have any children. So my 33-year-old, that means he saw Flash Gordon, you know, when he was, later, probably, I think the first time he saw it, maybe 7 or 8, but, you know, they were just, to me, it's dad, I'm their dad, you know, to get specific, I've noticed when they get older and their friends, you know, they say big deal, Dad, Flash Gordon, 52 other movies, Highwayman, big deal, Ted, big deal. But when their friends acknowledge to them, oh my God, your dad is Flash Gordon. You see, now there's a difference. It's amazing how that peer pressure works, either good or bad, you know?
Yeah, my family, you know, with Zachary, you know, never he's now in his 30s, but he never thought of anything. And it wasn't until somebody wants me to give an autograph for school. That would be really neat for me. And I went, now you show me respect. A little late.
Yeah.
Ask her about Ted.
the longer she remains, the longer she remains a pain in the ass, the better it is for me.
I don't know what it was. We have a similar history, and we both sort of went through a lot growing up. But the fact is, instead of going to the dark side or the light side, we really loved to play, and that kind of lyric childishness was perfect, of course, for that, for Flash Gordon. And we continue it. He has a lot of mutual respect for me. I think it's our personalities. Sal and I, we've gone through, like a lot of people have, difficult and certain dark demons that come into our lives. And we always went to the light. We always went to the positive. We always went to the playful. And I think that's part of our characters and why we get along.
Yeah, I think just keeping consistent, like Melody says. I mean, it's all about keeping that attitude, because I remember, look what she's done with her life, and look what I've done. I'm talking about outside of the movie industry. The early years for me, I can't speak for her, but I'm sure she'll comment on this. Early years for me was, an actor who's not working and not providing for his family finds himself, I'm only talking about me, finds himself looking at the television and saying, why didn't they hire me? I could have done better than that. The next thing you know, you're doing, wah, big baby, knock off the baby talk, get over yourself, and go out and get a job and provide for your family. And that was my wife who inspired me to do that. she basically, this is great, guys. Guys, listen to this, right? Listen to your wives, okay? Because this was 15 years ago. She said, I've been watching you for 6 months. You've been waiting for that phone to ring. That phone's not ringing. Now, we got 2 kids in diapers, 1 out of diapers. There's the door. Don't come back till you're providing for this family. So I had to look at my core competencies and my skill sets. Former Marine, brainstorm. Let me call my military buddies about this high-end security business. Long story short, I got plugged in. I got retrained up. I became a security professional, executive protection specialist, whatever you want to call it, bodyguard. So I moved to San Diego many years ago, where I've been running the cross-border security ops into the border cities of Mexico. And Melody obviously did the same thing. And she decided, what was her core competency other than being a great actress? Tell me. And you did what you did.
Cooking.
Come on.
Well, one of the reasons, I initially had gotten a degree in journalism in Canada. That's where I'm from. Because I love communicating and moving people. And then, for a whole gazillion reasons, I ended up acting. And I wanted to move people as well. I wanted to make them feel and laugh and relieve and touch sad emotions and all that. And, especially when you're in the San Antonio business, you're sort of a young athlete, your days are kind of numbered. And so I could see, the job getting less, and my girlfriends were a few years older than me, getting less and less work, and I am not going to be desperate. So I went back to university, got my master's in certification in trauma treatment, addiction treatment, all sorts of things, and because I want to move people. And the thing about being a therapist is everybody is a snowflake. You have to approach them differently. And being an actor allows you to be gentle with those who need it, a little bit more assertive when people need it. And so the two skills have really molded in together. So, I think we're very lucky not to think that that was the be all and end all. Not just of work, but of who we would be as people.
Right, we have to be.
Yeah.
And here's the follow-up to that. Here's the end result. Okay, when as a man, I just speak to a man, when we humble ourselves and get over ourselves, and we take on, I started a brand new vocation from 62. I started really the security profession in its full force at the age of 50. Okay, so what is this talk around America? I can't find a job. I can't find a job. I'm not a 50-year-old going out and starting a whole new vocation. But here's the end result. Okay, so we humble ourselves, and guess what happens? Just a couple years later, the phone starts to ring to do more movies and stuff. I mean, it's simple.
Signing.
It's simple.
And you're signing.
I mean, look at this. They're calling us back in to do these. It's wonderful. We get to do both now. We get to do both these different vocations. It's a blessing.
And I didn't go back and get my master's until I was 39.
Wow.
and I'm only 17 now.
I remember reading in a couple of those publications, you know, I still remember reading this when I was a kid, that originally it was planned to be a trilogy. And obviously it didn't work out that way. I was wondering if you could shed any insight on was it creative differences? Was it a money thing? Was it a budget shortfall? I mean, could you give insight up to why the sequels never happened?
Flash.
Yeah.
Sorry, brother.
Well, you know, Universe is an odd place, and we did really, really well throughout Europe. They promoted us like the mad dogs all throughout Asia, Australia, New Zealand, really through most of the through the world. In the States, for some reason, they didn't do as much promotion, and I don't know why that was. And we did okay. We didn't do the numbers we did over in Europe and in Asia. And there was also a disagreement between the brass at Universal and Dino, and you know, Universal is real, you know, like any big business. You know, it's either going to work for us or it's not. So they didn't want the hassles. So that, because as you know, at the end, it's designed for the sequel. What happened to that dream?
Biggest question mark in the
end. I know, and it was supposed to tie in, and then, you know, it just, you know, who knows what happens in those courtrooms, but I am thrilled with the movie that we made, and I think it should have had a sequel, because we had such wonderful actors and writers.
Thank you so much.
Molly, this is a question for you. I'd like to hear the Ted story.
You know, I didn't even give this man any money. There is no Ted sequel for me. No Ted first, no Ted second, and no Ted third. I actually have no idea. You know, of course, I'm very, very happy when my friends are working and making money. And so when Sam told me there was going to be a Ted 2, I said, speak to Sam. He, as a good friend and promoter, spoke to Sal. Number now. And number three? So you're going to have to take that up with Seth MacFarlane. I would like to. I'm trying to find out where he lives and get my car and put it through his front door. I see a new hashtag, Seth sucks.
Well, thank you, because yeah, I was going to ask about sequels, and then the chap in front of me had the same question, and thank you for the answer. But I have a question for Melody. There was talk about improvisation on certain scenes, and so I'm real curious as to where it was improvised from the script when you put down the gun and picked up high heels.
You know, because I am still a chick, right? I mean, we fight people out of a chick, and I do not leave the shoes behind.
We have follow-ups at 2:30?
No, right now.
No, 2:30.
So,
yeah, tell them, Joe, what did I say right there? The church, from 1 to 2, we have the panel here. How was the panel, by the way?
Make sure to bring it and give it the best.
2:30. So we're going to our table now,
we're
going to
start
and then signing. We have to leave at 2:30 for 30 minutes for a photo op.
And then we're there the rest
of the day. We're there the rest of the day.
All right, so come by. We want to hear your questions. Thank you all for coming. Thank you all.